Did a freshman congresswoman give a large group a tour of the Capitol in the days leading up to the insurrection? That is what one top House Democrat, Congressman Steve Cohen of Tennessee, told CNN earlier today.
We saw Congressman Boebert taking a group of people for a tour sometime after the 3rd and before the 6th. I don't remember the day we were walking in the Cannon tunnel. We saw her and commented that who she was, and she had a large group with her. Now, whether they were people that were involved in the or not, I do not know. She was a freshman. She might have had a large number of people coming to be with her on this historic occasion and just wanting to give them the opportunity to have a tour. But it was pretty clear that her team is the team. She's not on the home team. She was with the visitors.
Now, Capitol tours have actually ceased because of coronavirus. Some Democrats have alleged that a GOP colleague gave a, quote, reconnaissance tour of the Capitol the day before the mob swarmed the building. But Cohen says he's not sure if any of the people in Congresswoman Lauren Boebert's group took part in the riot. We should be clear on that. I want to bring in Manu Raju on Capitol Hill. What is Boebert saying about this, Manu?
Well, she has actually been accused of this over the last several days, and some Democratic members have suggested that she had a role here, and she has pushed back. She sent a letter last week to one Democratic congressman saying that she had not have given a, did not give a tour to the insurrectionists. She said that she did go a walk around the Capitol with her family. She said it was her mom, according to this letter that I'm looking at now that she sent. She said it was her mom, her children, her husband, her uncle, and to their mother was the only one of those family members in Washington, D.C. on the 6th. And she said during the riots, my mother was locked in a secure location in the U.S. Capitol with my staff and never left their sight. So she is denying that she had any role in providing inside information to these insurrectionists. She has gotten a fair amount of attention as one of the members who tried to challenge the results of the elections. And she also saw some controversy over the last several days or had a staff shakeup over the last several days when her communications director quit because of her role in trying to challenge the election results. She has gotten some controversy too because she has bragged about carrying firearms around Capitol Hill. She got into a standoff with Capitol Police after they put on metal detectors to get into the House chambers. But nevertheless, on this issue, she denies having any role. But there's an investigation ongoing to see if any members had any role. We'll see if there any evidence emerges. She's saying that there's no evidence pointing to her role in any of this. Brianna.
All right, Manu, thank you so much. Manu Raju, live from Capitol Hill. With less than 46 hours left in Donald Trump's presidency, CNN has learned President Trump is preparing to issue roughly 100 pardons and commutations on his final day in office, his final full day. For now, CNN has been told that he does not intend to take the unprecedented step of pardoning himself or any of his family members. The New York Times reports some of the president's allies are collecting fees from wealthy felons or their associates to lean on Trump for possible last-minute pardons. Neil Eggleston is a former White House counsel under President Obama, and he oversaw the clemency program under Obama. Neil, you have very specific expertise to this, so I'm so glad that you could be on to talk with us about it. And I think we can agree it doesn't seem ethical to sell a presidential pardon or get paid a ton of money for access. Is this legal?
Well, it certainly is questionable. Now, I assume the lawyers and the people who are peddling their access are claiming it's for their personal time and there's nothing improper going on. But I think the spectacle, which is fairly consistent with what's happened in the Trump administration, of monetizing indeed another portion of our government, which is the president's pardon power, is hardly surprising and is really to be condemned, in my view.
When it comes to pardons, so far President Trump has given clemency to far fewer than President Obama and some other recent presidents. So take us through the final 48 hours of the pardoning process and what typically goes on behind the scenes at the White House, in the Oval Office, at the Justice Department.
Sure. We had a very different process than what you're seeing or we're hearing about here. You know, President Obama decided and made it clear to me that he was going to use his constitutional power, pardon power, for social justice and social good. And that is the clemency that he decided to grant to a lot of people who are serving life sentences and significantly long sentences for their involvement in nonviolent and many of them relatively trivial drug crimes, mostly from the 1990s. And that's really what we were working on. And as I say, he really wanted to focus his power on giving new lives to people who were incarcerated, and that's really what we were about. This frantically running around and trying to figure out which of his supporters can bring him a new person to benefit, that's just not the way we went about it. And President Obama made it very clear that in a short time and scarce resource world, that's not where he wanted to focus his attention. And so that's not at all what happened at the end of the Obama administration.
Right now, it appears the president is now leaning away from something that he had asked about, which was pardoning himself, that he is now leaning away from pardoning his family members or some close associates. If that changes, though, or, you know, do you see that changing? And if it does, will that hold up to legal challenges?
Well, it's my view. There's been some debate, legal debate about this, although I think it's actually fairly clear that a president cannot pardon himself. I think if you think about it, that's the ultimate free pass that places the president of the United States above the law. And I think it's pretty clear our framers, who just came out of a monarchy, had no sense that the right way to go is to let the president of the United States place himself above the law. That's not at all what they were thinking. And I think most originalists would agree with me on that. So I think that would be not recognized and not be lawful if he attempted.